great Peter Shilton. But today she stands alone.
Well, it's a magic moment for Rachel Yankee, who becomes the most capped player in history for England. Appearance number 126 coming up for the Arsenal winger, one more than Peter Shilton. You're very welcome to the Pirelli Stadium here in Burton. It's England's penultimate warm-up match before next month's European Championship. I'm joined by the former England captain, Faye White. And Faye, what an achievement for Rachel Yankee. Some 16 years, obviously, she first played for her country.
Yes, certainly. It's fantastic to see Rachel being presented there. But she's been an incredible ambassador and role model for the women's game for such a long period. And that's a brilliant achievement.
Here's the Japanese national anthem. Actually, a fair few Japanese supporters in the ground, obviously not as many as the England fans that are here. Plenty of youngsters too, taking the day off school as we prepare now to hear God Save the Queen. Just about perfect playing conditions. Temperature around 20 degrees, no rain, and here's the England side. Hope Powell still has to cope with a few injury niggles in the squad, but it's just about the strongest side she could name. In the absence of skipper Casey Stoney, Laura Bassett partners Sophie Bradley in central defence, and Ellen White leads the line. Japan have plenty of star names on show, although the biggest miss is their record goal scorer, Amare Sawa, who isn't in the squad. She's retired, so she can't add to her phenomenal 81 international goals. Their fresh but 1-1 draw against New Zealand last week. Striker Yuki Ajimi scored the goal, and she starts up front this afternoon. Expect the experienced Kazue Ando to try and run the game from midfield.
11, Shinobu Ono.
Well, England couldn't really have asked for a tougher assignment, Faye, could they, against the world champions and Olympic silver medalists?
No, definitely. They've got an unbelievable amount of skill and quality all over the field. Very technical team. Like to keep the ball. England will have to go long periods of this game not in possession, having to keep a good defensive shape and not allowing them to unlock their defence. But this is the kind of game Hope certainly wants to test her team against, and the players will want to, they'll be relishing in this challenge after the last time they played them in the 2011 World Cup.
What do you make of what Hope Powell said recently? She said that the gap between the best teams in the world and the rest is narrowing. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, definitely. I remember when I was playing the first few years in England, we would go out against teams like this and not have a hope. We'd go just trying to improve ourselves, trying to learn from them. But now there's a real belief within the players and the squad that they, when they come up against the likes of Japan, Germany, America, we can on our day when we perform how we know we can beat these teams.
Iwasa Mizu, the centre-half there, the number three, who's the Japan captain. You might have just seen it was Rachel Yankee shaking hands with her Yankee skipper for the day to mark her achievement of 126 caps. The ever-smiling Norio Sasaki, the Japanese coach, been in charge for 5 years, and what success he's brought to the nation. culminating, of course, in that World Cup triumph just 2 years ago. England in their huddle. We're not too far away from kickoff. The referee, incidentally, is Lynn Anderson from Sweden, which is entirely appropriate because, of course, that's the venue for the European Championships. And in fact, England have a friendly against Sweden next week before they embark on three really tough group games: Spain, Russia and France. I mean, it's a big ask just to get out of the group with those three.
Yeah, but you expect that now in any major tournament, and certainly that first game's against Spain. Spain actually, in the last European qualifiers and the World Cup for 2011 qualifiers, that we were the reason that they didn't in advance. So there'll certainly be a bit of revenge mission for Spain in that first game.
And that first game is on July the 12th. If you want to make a note in your diaries, all the news and all the stories here on FA TV. 55 years old, Sasaki, the Japanese coach. And we are just about set here. Very good crowd, as you can see. Capacity is around about 7,000. Doesn't appear to be too far short of that. Lots of youngsters in, as I mentioned. You can see a few Japanese flags as well amongst the supporters. Away we go. England, of course, in white, attacking the goal away to our left in this first half. And one of the areas I'm looking at particularly, Faye, the centre-half pairing of Sophie Bradley and Laura Bassett with no Casey Stoney. Might be a tough afternoon for both those girls.
Yeah, but they're experienced. They've been in the squad a long time now. Laura Bassett plays the centre-half for Birmingham, has a good lot of quality about her.
Knocked on by Aluko, and already this is threatening for England. It was Farrah Williams who nearly got in. It's come out to Alex Scott. Yankee. A powerful run from Scott again. She's beaten about three of them, and no free kick. They all look towards Lynn Anderson, who said play on. And immediately, that was a rather nervy clearance from Kaori, the Japanese goalkeeper. Wasn't done any favours by the back pass.
And it's encouraging to see there Alex Scott getting quite high up. Normally a favourite position and a regular position is right back, but today she's been asked to fill in at left back, probably hope just experience because of Steph Holton is out with a slight injury, and I think she's well on her way to recover, but she needs to have that cover on that side of the field.
No way through for Jill Scott, recovered by Anita Asante, plays in Sweden, so she should be at home next month, plays at Gothenburg Club. Interesting that Kaori's in goal today, because it was mooted that Fukumoto would probably be between the sticks. She's a real battle with Kaori for the number one spot. Kaori was in goal for that 2011 World Cup. Ono in possession. Just showed a little bit too much of it to Enialuko. Nice and calm on the ball, Susie. And a first touch. A lot of first touch for Karen Bardsley, who's been in excellent form this season for her club, Lincoln City. Guess she gets a lot of practice. They've struggled a bit, Lincoln, this season.
Yeah, they certainly have, but they, with Rick Passmore as their manager, has secured them and made them a lot more defensive. But to have that signing in Karen Bardsley is a great signing for them for this season.
Dangerous ball forward, but safely taken by Bardsley. Keepers always want to have an early touch. Played all four games of the last World Cup. That friendly, incidentally, against Sweden is next Thursday. So both in this game and that one, the last chance for Hope Powell to experiment if she wants to. But I'm pretty sure she knows what side she wants to field in the first game against Spain. But whether she'll be able to field it with injuries, none the matter.
Yeah, that's right. I think she's entered this preparation with a few doubts in her mind. Obviously, those players have made the squad, so they believe that they will be fit and ready in time. But these games are ideal to try those players, like for the likes of Laura Bassett to come in, get good game time and have that test, because it's important she knows she can bring those players in. And we also have a lot of youngsters now, five young players that have played in the 2009 Championship in for the under-19s, and they were winners of that tournament. So for them, the likes of Jordan Nobbs, Jade Moore, Lucy Bronze to come into the squad as well adds real depth for us.
Scored in possession, Yankee, but they forced Japan back. 13 is Itsugi. Play either in defence or as a holding midfielder, too far ahead of Hajime, who, as I mentioned, got the goal that got Japan a draw against New Zealand. They should have won that game, actually. New Zealand with a very, very late leveller. Plays in Germany at Turbine Potsdam.
It's interesting to see for Japan that Kumagai, number four, and Sakaguchi are in midfield, because Kumagai normally is a centre-half for Japan. So I know that she plays there for Potsdam in midfield.
Osafume appears to be slotted in at centre-half for this game. There's the captain, Erosha Mizu. Just welcoming Rachel Yankee to the 126 cap club with that challenge. Yankee will take the free kick herself. Good one too. Well, I say that's disappointing. Offside flag went up. Farrah Williams looks a bit mystified by that. Quite settled yet, Japan, and that's good news for England. Here's Asante. Just making Bradley backtrack a little. Now Bassett.
It's quite pleasing early on to see that England have got the possession and controlling it a little bit and winning the ball back quite quickly. And like you say, Japan haven't quite settled into their normal playing style.
Plenty of distance on Karen Barnsley's clearance. Sante getting it to Aluko. There's a nice little touch which nearly reached Jules Scott, and if it had done, England might have been in business, but they've won it back quickly again. This is Aluko. It's a right idea. Oh, tell you what, this might be an own goal. Just goes wide. What a let off for Japan that was. That could have been an absolute bonus. She might be smiling, Osafune, and her goalkeeper. She wouldn't have been if that had been an OG.
Yeah, it's certainly a rare mistake from normally the superior kind of technical ability of the Japanese side.
It all came about because England were applying pressure, hassling and harrying. It's not the worst ball in. Went for the dramatic overhead. Ellen White looking for a goal of the season candidate. Didn't really make any kind of connection. Here's the near miss. Well, goalkeeper, I don't think, could do a lot about that.
Yeah, it's not the best pass back for her. You see the ball's bouncing, and that's a very hard ball to expect the keeper to control.
Osafune's blushes spared early on here in Burton. It's only her seventh cap, Osafune, just 23. She is one of the youngest players in the side. I was actually in Japan best part of a year ago for the under-20 Women's World Cup, and Japan finished third. They were by far the most attractive side to watch in that tournament, but not too many of those players have broken into the first team as of yet. And this looks rather dangerous. First shot in anger. Down goes Barnsley. Ono's effort. Didn't quite get the power she wanted.
Yeah, but you could see there when Japan do start getting their passes flowing and playing into feet, how they can unlock a defence and gets their first shot. Ono gets her first shot on goal.
Jill Scott described Japan as the Barcelona of the women's game, and we know what she means because they do play some lovely football.
Yeah, they're, like I said, they're all very comfortable on the ball, very often very good with both feet, but they will look to keep possession and try to play through, you know, the thirds. They won't look for the long ball because all players are the comfortable on the ball. And I certainly remember in 2011 when England did beat them in 2-0 in their group final group game. The tactic of sitting back and just crowding them out in midfield, the two wingers would sit back and make it hard for them to play through. So that was very much the tactic then, and look to kind of get them on the counter and use our pace.
City doing well on that far side. It was cut out by Osafune. Test of her character after that early anxious moment. Osafune again. So Susie will restart with the England throw.
This is a great opportunity for Dunja as well to kind of show what she can bring to the game in right back. She often plays right wing for her club, Chelsea, but has that great defensive ability, uses her pace great in that position. But this will be a big start for her to play against the world champions.
So far, so good with 10 minutes gone, and excellent work from Ellen White to win that. She had no right to, really. She just couldn't get the pass off to Yankee, who would have had a clear run down this near touchline. Instead, it's Ajimi for Japan. Nicely done by Sakaguchi. Just trying again to play that little ball in behind England. Too far ahead of Ono that time, but the threat's clearly there.
Yeah, and you can see that they're quite comfortable to play through the middle of the park. They're not looking to get the ball out wide and use that space often on the wings. They're passing so crisp and precise that they look to unlock teams right down the middle, and their midfield two are very key in playing those balls through for Agumi and Ono to run onto, because their runs, they're very comfortable in running just off the back shoulder of the defender, but also getting it to feet and setting up the play.
Yeah, that was a perfect example, wasn't it? You could see Ono almost looking where the last defender was, making sure she was onside and then making the run. Fortunately for England, nothing came of it. Helped on by White. England have four in the middle here, but they can't get the ball in for now. There might be a break on for the Japanese. Just got sucked out of position there, Bassett. That's nicely done by Kawasumi. Might be a tap-in. It should have been a tap-in for Ando. Let off for England this time.
Yeah, I think they were fortunate that Kawasumi didn't quite take that ball into her stride either, because she was directly through. Just here you see that she doesn't quite get it out in front of her feet, but still manages to retain possession, get the ball out wide and get a good cross in. And we're fortunate that Japan and Indo didn't quite connect there.
Maybe did her a slight disservice. She might have been just stretching a little bit, but clear and present danger for England there.
It just shows that the two pairings in Laura Bassett and Sophie Bradley are going to have to be so on their toes, just because the movement of the Japanese is so good, and the players, you know, Ando and Ono, they're quite comfortable swapping positions as well, and Ono can come out wide.
England have lost it again here, but not the best of deliveries. And Asante will clear for Hope Powell's side.
It's important as well, as England do look to go forward, that Anita Asante, often out of the two players, is the player that in midfield that would like to sit and just protect those two centre-halves a little bit with the movement of the two forward players for Japan.
Yeah, I felt a bit sorry for Laura Bassett in that last chance, because the ball was lost in midfield. She had to advance, close down the Japanese player on the ball, and that meant that England were a bit light behind her. Fortunately, Japan unable to capitalise. scored by Farrah Williams. Farrah Williams, one of four England players in the squad for the Euros with a century of caps. You've mentioned Rachel Yankee, Smith, Stoney and Williams, the other three. So certainly no shortage of experience in the camp.
No, certainly not. And you've also got Alex Scott, who's tapping on the door. And I believe if she does play all the group games, we'll get 100 out in Sweden as well.
Yep. And once again, Ono was the target, didn't reach her. Sorted out by Scott. Luca playing a little deeper than sometimes we see her. Too far over White's head, the attempted through ball. Yankee. Luco might get onto this. And that's a good challenge from Ando.
It's good to see there. You're actually seeing Rachel Yankee just filling in at left back, because Alex Scott, I mean, that's the thing the Japanese do to you. They pull you out of position, and often you have to go with that run. And so it's important for players to be able to just take up the team shape very quickly. Because we've got Rachel Yankee at left back, you've got Eni Aluko on the left side as well, and you know they should be on opposite sides of the field really in their full winger roles really.
I think Asante is an important player for England today, Faye. She's just got to hold in front of that back four, try and give them a bit of protection and occasionally get forward as well. But this is more promising. It's Alex Scott for England. Yankee in a more accustomed position on the left wing. Is a really dangerous ball too. Not too far away from Ellen White either.
Yeah, that's what Rachel's good at. She doesn't need to beat a player. She just often gets half a yard to be able to get those dangerous crosses in.
Farrah Williams' chip fell straight to the feet of Ariyoshi. Sugi. I think Hope Power will be reasonably pleased with the first quarter of an hour. The team have given as good as they've got so far.
Yeah, certainly. You know, when we've had the ball as well, we've been able to find another White shirt's feet and advance up the field like they are doing right now.
That's good work between Scott and Eni Aluke as Yankee plays it in. Just too high for White. Goal kick.
But I think it's these kind of games where we do excel. It's when there isn't any pressure, the players can just go out and express themselves. And against a team like Japan, they know that, you know, they're world champions, so they want to go out and prove a point. I think it's, you know, putting these performances into the major tournaments and being able to always perform like that, even when there is pressure on those games, certainly if you get to the latter phases in a tournament, because it's often when we've come up against the expectation of beating another side in the quarters, or that, you know, that's where we've not quite fulfilled our playing style and our ability of as much as we would like as an England team.
Is there a slight mental thing to it, do you think, or is it just that, you know, sometimes games are so tight, we've lost obviously penalty shootouts in recent matches, you can't do much about that, but the line between success and failure is getting progressively slimmer?
Yeah, I just think it's having that major win in a tournament over a big team.
Chance here for White! Very difficult angle, to be fair to her. Certainly Kaori was scrambling to her right, but I think it may have missed by 2 or 3 yards. Let's have a look.
It's a good ball through, and this is what Ellen White will do. She's not afraid to, you know, from these tighter angles out wide to have a shot, and she's looking just for that far post there, but not quite. She's just a few inches wide. But that's good for her to have the confidence to get her shots off and to make those runs off the centre half into that channel to find that space.
Well, Ellen White, of course, has scored that wonder goal against Japan in the World Cup a couple of years ago. England beat Japan 2-0 in that group game. So it's not as if they can't beat the best. A good win over Canada in the Cyprus Cup, which they won a couple of months back.
Yeah, and like you say, I think that 2-0 win in a major tournament against a good team, and for them then Japan to go on and win it, but for us to look back as the only team that beat them in the tournament, is a major confidence boost for the team. And like you say, as an emerging nation, we've been growing and believing in our abilities, but always that final hurdle, just not quite done it when the, you know, the games and the quarterfinals, when we've needed to be able to bring out that performance and just get over that last little bit.
Ariyoshi for Japan, the right back. She asked a little bit too much of Kamaki. And now England on the break with Aluko. Options both sides for her. She might not need anyone. She didn't. Oh, what a good effort. Side netting only. Well, that was a really purposeful run from Eni Aluko.
Yeah, it's a brilliant drive through the middle. I think Farrah Williams had just come out to her left, and I think that she kind of went off to the right, but if she could have come just in that option on the left and put Farrah through, there's also another England player coming up as well. It's almost 4-on-3, and took the shot, but I think a better option going out left.
Well, it was on target, but clearly you saw deflected wide for the corner, which Rachel Yankee will deliver from that far side. Header out was by Sakaguchi, go very far. Still England trying to press, Scott battling away for it.
That's an area where we should have a little bit more advantage over the Japanese is at corners in this height that we have in Jill Scott.
And this is where Japan are dangerous. Kawasumi, they break so quickly. It's a really good ball and an even better challenge.
Yeah,
fabulous tackle.
Unbelievable challenge. Great tracking by Laura Bassett there. She saw the danger, and she does that so well in timing her tackles to be, you know, put the last tackle in when needed.
But if she'd got that wrong, it would have been a stonewall penalty and possibly a red card as well. But we got the ball cleanly. Another example, the likes of Kawasumi and Ono breaking so quickly as Japan turned defence into attack in the blink of an eye. Here's Iwashimizu. Ajimi. She's gone for the return and she's got it, Ajimi. This time she's gone past the centre-half, but too much on the cross. Luko's got to be careful there. Her attacking instincts. And to be fair to her, she got back and got a really solid challenge in, and then under pressure, found a teammate.
Yeah, that's something in training that Hope often wants the team to do and practice, is playing themselves out of danger rather than in those positions just putting it forward and losing possession. But I think sometimes you do have to make that decision when to and when not to, but she's recovered well.
So no exaggeration to say we could have had goals at both ends as we pass the 20 minute mark here, but it remains goalless in Burton.
You can see there just how confident Japan are playing the ball into midfield, even when the player's got someone very close under quite close pressure from the England. But they're just so comfortable on the ball to be able to do that.
Just a few signs that Japan are starting to feel their way into the game. That's a lovely layoff, and they're round the back again, and that wasn't the best option. I think it was a shot. Smile from Ono. Had couple of teammates available. Let's have a look, see if it was a shot. I think it was.
Yeah, you can see she just carried on her run. I think Rachel Yankee happened to be the closest player to her.
That was the excellent tackle just a moment ago from Laura Bassett.
That's the thing with the Japanese players, they're very good at, when they pass the ball, that they don't stand there and admire it. They're very much looking for another angle, looking to run off another a defender or a player to make that space for someone else on the ball.
Is Osafune. Just two uncapped players in Hope Powell's squad for the Euros. Both the Liverpool defenders, Gemma Bonner and Lucy Bronze. Japan threaten again with Ando. There is space far side and three waiting. Onto the right foot, but driven rather tamely wide in the end from Kawasumi.
Yeah, again, does well to just make an angle for the shot, but with her ability not testing the keeper, she really should be doing better there.
10 international goals for the Kobe striker. Scored a couple in Sweden, the World Cup semi-final. One of them was absolutely brilliant. I remember lob from fully 35 yards. A decent clearance from Bardsley. Picked up here by Ando for Japan. Pointing to her right is Ajimi. Good work from Alex Scott. Very experienced international for more than a decade, but still potential danger here from the Japan corner. I think it's their first, and we're just past the midway point of the first period. Just a tip from Karen Bardsley, and that goes harmlessly wide.
Yeah, Karen Bardsley at corners is off very commanding in her box, and as a defender that gives you confidence. You can see the three main headers just line up on the edge of the six-yard box, giving her space to come. She just managed to get a touch to that. But she's got good presence, good height.
And she's got the confidence to try and do that, which is so important. She might not have got as much of that corner as she wanted, but it's so important for the defenders around her to know that their goalkeeper's capable of coming for corners and free kicks.
Yeah, that she's not afraid to, and that, like say, she has that commanding presence and clearly communicates it as well, which is important.
Ariyoshi. Oshimizu for Japan, the captain. 26 years of age, she's only 10 shy of 100 caps for her country. Yoshi again, hassled and harried by Scott. Ando's onside here though, and with time to measure across, she'll pick this up again. A lot deeper that time, goalkeeper had to stay at home. The looping header had to be tipped over, she couldn't take any chances with that.
Yeah, I think that's actually come off of an England head. Just have a look again, but it looks like, yeah, Dunja Susie, she's not quite been able to get that. Probably needs to just flick that on behind her out of danger rather than back across the goal.
So another corner, which Ando will take again. Barnsley's in no man's land here, and she got a little fortunate. I think she actually misjudged the flight of that.
Yeah, on that occasion, has come out too early, and that ball was a lot deeper, and certainly flew over her head, and she's left the goal unattended.
No harm done, though.
It just shows the importance of assessing the flight of the ball really early for a keeper.
Well, no question that as the half has worn on, Japan have begun to look more and more threatening.
And that is one strength within the Japanese anyway. They believe in the way they play, and that their ability will bring them into the game, and for periods that they, even if they're under pressure, they will have times where they obviously cause teams problems up the other end, so they keep persevere with the way that they like to play.
Luko yet it to Asante. Laura Bassett found herself playing midfield for a moment there. She's jogged back now. Ariyoshi.
But you can see again there, Agimi's getting a lot of the ball. She likes to come to feet to pick it off either the midfield or the wide players, and interchanges those positions with the midfield player maybe running on into the space that she's created. But it's good that England are keeping the defence, Laura Bassett and Sophie Bradley, when needed. It's more on Laura Bassett's side that she's actually just keeping it under pressure not allowing her to turn and asking her to play the ball back.
Bardsley's clearance kept in play, but sorted out by Ariyoshi. Iwasha Mizu. Should be easy for Bradley. And Susie. England qualified unbeaten for the European Championship finals. It's our best previous effort, as Faye will know only too well, losing to Germany in the 2009 final.
Yeah, obviously that whole experience of getting that far and getting to the final at that time was a brilliant achievement for the team, but Germany, five times champions, going for their sixth this time round, is obviously a major hurdle to have to overcome in a final, and they just showed on that occasion their experience. And but it was a good experience for the team, and I think we'll grow, and we certainly have pushed on from then.
Well, with nearly half an hour gone, England holding the world champions here in Burton. Rachel Yankee actually scored in her first appearance all those years ago, back in 97. Here's Farrah Williams. Maybe you're quite cleverly there. Might fall for any Aluko. Determined to go for goal. It was a shot. She did have a couple of players waiting in the middle, including White.
Yeah, but good ball over by Farrah. She made the space on the left wing. But Annie does it right there to try and... she didn't have many other options, and it's on her right foot. And to try and hit that far post, maybe against make the keeper make a save, and it could have dropped to Alexis Scott feet. She's very high up, advanced up the field.
Yeah, she was the furthest player forward there, the England fullback. Any mistakes from goalkeeper Kaori and she would have pounced. Back on defensive duty now, though. Picked up by Ajimi. Iwasha Mizu to Kamagi. That's a nice piece of skill from Sakaguchi, and she'll get the free kick in a threatening position here.
Yeah, very dangerous position. But yeah, great little bit of footwork by Sakaguchi. Yeah, she just nips it past Anita as she's dived in, thinking she can win it. But they need to organise here, get that wall secure and make it, make sure it's in the right position, because Japan are very threatening from these kind of positions.
Well, Karen Barnsley trying to get a view, trying to get that wall exactly where she wants it. We've got Kawasumi as part of the England brickwork as well. So about 25 yards, you'd say. And it's a good effort and good handling as well from Bardsley. Jimmy got it on target, but the goalkeeper had it covered all the way.
Yeah, she just gets it in that space where the Japanese are just breaking up the England defence. She gets it up and over, but quite an easy one for Karen Bardsley to handle.
Little spell for Japan at the moment. Decisions originally went to England, but the referees overruled her assistant.
It's actually interesting to see that Imiyama is not in their squad at the moment, because she is their specialist for set pieces, takes a lot of their corners and their free kicks, and is her ability at that is amazing, but she's not even in the team sheet today.
No, in the squad, but not going to be involved this afternoon. It might break here for Aluka. Didn't have many options in front of her. It's in towards White. That's wonderfully controlled. Aluka again! How close was that? That would have been a wonderful goal.
Yeah, brilliant takedown by Ellen White. She could see it going overhead, and she just sticks out one of that long leg to bring it down brilliantly, and just a little set back, and Aluko does brilliantly to just get out of her feet and try and curls it into that top corner, but again, just a few inches wide on this occasion. But that's encouraging, a good sign for England.
That was fabulous hold-up play from White, wasn't it? Because it was a really awkward ball to control. Meanwhile, here's Ando, who's been very involved, especially in the last 10 or 15 minutes or so.
But again, it's this kind of situation when, you know, you just need to get back to the team shape and make sure that Japan don't get too much space in midfield to kind of, you know, run the game from there.
Picked up by Sakaguchi. Don't often see Japan play it that long. No surprise, it wasn't particularly accurate.
You can see as well when Japan do get the ball at the back that England are sitting deep. Certainly the wingers in Rachel Yankee and Aluko are dropping in just to, you know, it's loud saying you can have the ball there, but you're not going to try and play through us. And then, that pushes the team back a little bit. And there's not that space in behind for the Japanese to play those long balls over. And that's not their style anyway.
On the chest of White again. Two defenders to deal with that time. And it's back with Ando, who has Ajimi ahead of her. Good challenge. Referee had a good view of that. Said that White played the ball. Sure that Ando would agree.
No, very good time challenge, worked hard, got back and has won the possession back for England.
Yankee. Farrah Williams. Bit of possession will do England the power of good. Japan had more of the ball in the last few moments. Will be an offside flag here against Jill Scott.
Yeah, she'd already made that run and just checked, but and then any Aluko seen it, but played it a little bit late.
Here's the challenge by White. Well, that's the perfect camera angle. Couldn't see a better time tackle than that. She came in from the side, not from behind. Sure, that'll impress Hope Powell that her centre forward's coming back and making challenges like that.
Yeah, but Ellen White, that's the main strength that she has. Obviously, she's good goal scoring ability, but it's her work rate for the team and her willingness to do the ugly side of the game. And often you'll see her chasing down the two centre halves. And I mean, I often said to her when she's playing, because she expels so much energy doing that she has to pick and choose in the game the right moments to do that, not just to do it, you know, all the time, because it's not going to be effective for her game.
Well, that looked like a hand by Ando. Certainly wasn't given. England have a player down in the meantime. It's Scott. Jill Scott. But it looked a clear handball by Ando. Might have got away with one there, Japan.
It looks like she just gets the forearm across her throat. Don't think intentional, just across the face, hand in the face.
Ajimi, the player involved.
But again, you see there, she's just so good at holding up the ball, and you know, she often will entice the centre half out with her, you know, often making space in for another player to run into. But she does good link-up play for her team.
She's always gesticulating something, Sasaki, the Japanese coach. And Japan sportingly knock it out to give England the throw. Just being hemmed in a little bit at the moment, Hope Powell's side. I'll give Japan credit for that. That's all she could do really, was knock it out, Alex Scott. Nicely done by Hajimi. Oh, nervous moment there for Susie. And there's still a threat from Japan. Susie trying to recover the area. I think a real job clearing this. Still there's a threat. Good block from Asante. Scott going in. In the end, it was Aluko got it away. Bit of a tidal wave of blue going forward at the moment, though, Faye.
Yeah, it's a little bit scrappy for England's defence not to really clear it. Dunya's had two occasions, but kind of she's facing her own goal across the penalty box. Doesn't really want to clear it in that direction, but she just needs to be able to hook it over and get it out wide.
Game being played almost exclusively in England's half at the moment. Susanna White. It's been picked off by Ariyoshi. Got the better of Farrah Williams there. She might get another chance here. Sakaguchi. See how many Japan players waiting in the area. Four of them. And they'll all stay there for the corner.
I think Kawasumi should have done a little bit better with that cross in the end. She's will pick someone out, but she's in the little tame hit against Dunya instead to get the corner.
Sufune amongst those waiting to score for her country. Well, that's really well taken by Barnsley. Made that look very, very easy.
I think it's this time of the game that England just need to keep moving. They need to keep the ball moving, but also in their as players just keep rotating and moving and giving options for players on the ball. Because it's about now when you feel a little bit tired of in the first half, and you just need to keep your concentration, and the best way of doing that is by keeping the ball.
Susie trying to take on Kawasumi.
That's one thing that Japan are so good. When they don't have the ball, they really crowd out and pressure the ball really hard.
Well, here's some good pressure from England. Oh. And that slid in dangerously. And England lead. Eddie Aluko and the world champions behind. Really well made goal.
Yeah, it's brilliantly taken by Eddie Aluko. She's just had a sniff earlier, but with a shot that she tried to curl into the top corner. But here's a good little give off. She plays it to Jill Scott, who lays it off to Rachel and just sees her run. There's a great ball through the defence and just perfect, inch perfect into her feet, and that's a situation where the Japanese were unpicked, and I think Asufi is just literally just allowed Eni to just pull off her shoulder, and she's put that away superbly, and it'll give great confidence now going into the break with only 3 minutes left. Perfect time to score.
14th correction international goal. Eni Aluko. She was born in Nigeria but moved to Birmingham when she was just a baby. She's been playing for England full side for almost a decade. Her goal provides the size. That's going to be a yellow card for Farrah Williams. There was a tug of the shorts there.
Yeah, she got crowded out and has lost possession, and just she knows it, and she's just pulled the player back, thinking, oh, you know, doesn't want to let her team get countered on.
Here it is.
But that's what I said. The Japanese do so well is get numbers around the ball when they don't have the ball, but when they do win it back, they just seem to be able to find the space again. They open up their team shape so quick that players then seem to have acres of space on the ball, and that's just down to work rate and their the changing over a possession and seeing that so quickly that they're then in the right position to offer support to the player who has won the ball back.
Meanwhile, England charging forward again, and there's too much on the pass though.
Yeah, that's a frustrating thing with Farah. She has so much ability, but sometimes in a way that she does it, it looks a little bit casual and she just overhits the ball, and you think for someone of her ability, she shouldn't be having periods in the game like that. But she'll be pleased to be starting today, because during the Olympics, she didn't, for Team GB, didn't start as many games as I know she would have liked. She went through a bit of a low spell in her career and not playing, you know, very regularly, but for now she's moved to Liverpool in the WSL and has started fantastically well for them, and that would have given her a new lease of life, I think, moving teams and having a new challenge. And for her to then come into the team, she needs to show today, over 100 caps of experience, but she needs to show that, you know, she warrants putting that shirt on in the tournament coming up.
Foul on Ono by Jill Scott. Not a difficult decision for the referee to give. And England have to stay strong here. Just a few seconds left in this first half.
Yeah, it's important they keep high on that penalty box line. They don't drop deep. It allows the space for Cameron Barnsley to command behind them, but they need to stay with their runners.
In by Tsugi. Once again, Cameron Barnsley was a little bit in no man's land. And as we head for stoppage time here, it's a Japan corner.
Yeah, in my opinion, in that situation, Cameron Barnsley does not need to come. It's well out of her kind of area where she would be coming. She needs to just allow her defenders to clear that.
Minutes of additional time as the corner comes in. It was almost a free header, which was put fairly tamely wide in the end. It was Sakaguchi who got in there. Here it was.
There's a little bit, I just seen there as well, number 17, Nagumi, was actually making a run for it. It went over her, but completely unmarked, and she needs to have slightly close attention. But that's England do use the zonal approach of marking at corners rather than picking up player for player.
Helped on by Sakaguchi, but no one that far forward in a Japan shirt. Obviously, Hopel's going to love the scoreline, Faye, but what do you think she'll make of England's display in this first 45 minutes?
Well, knowing Hope, if you actually were going in one up against a team like Japan, she won't let you get carried away with it. She'll certainly say, well done, but this wasn't right. You need to keep team shape. We need to, when we lose possession, get back into that positions quicker and not allow them space through the middle to play. But she'll be picking out this. They often use a lot of video feedback at halftime as well, picking out those situations where they might have, opened the team up. So she will certainly keep the feet on the ground and say that that's good, but more of the same, really. We've looked comfortable in some positions in attacking them as well, but I think it's when we've lost possession and needlessly and sloppily the dangers that Japan can pose on the team. We need to stop them doing that.
Excellent scoreline, though, at the break. The goal coming late in the half from Eni Aluko. Really well-fashioned and expertly taken as well. No chance for Kaiori. And it means the half-time score here at the Pirelli Stadium in Burton is England 1, Japan. Well, as you can see, plenty of Japanese fans in the crowd here showing their support for their side. Doesn't appear, just looking at that shot, that there are too many substitutions made by Norio Sasaki.
Replacing number 7, Kazue Ando. Here's number 20, Emi Nakajima.
Well, Emi Nakajima is on, and she's come on for Sue Ando. Changes appear to be kept at a minimum here.
So welcome back the teams for the second half here. Half-time score, England
there
won.
There is Emi Nakajima.
Get behind your side.
Just 22, the Kobe midfielder, one of the youngest players in this Japanese squad. So that'll be a straight swap, midfielder for midfielder. He came to every game at the Under-20 World Cup in his own country last year. The coach there, Sasaki, looking for the next generation Japanese talent. But the world champions get us underway for the second half here, trailing to that 41st minute goal from Eni Aluko. I have to think it's important that England start the second half well, as 45 minutes is a long time to play on the back foot. Nearly an opening there for Jill Scott, and she's taken a while to get up.
Back to her feet now, so she has to shake off a few tackles within 90 minutes.
I tell you that, as far as we know, no changes to the England side, just that one change to the Japan team that I mentioned. Here's Osafune, who just made that challenge on Scott. It's Kawasumi. Quick feet from Ono. Nice ball at the end of it too. I'm quite sure what Otsugi was trying to do there. We haven't actually seen her make too many overlapping runs down the left-hand side, have we, the fullback?
No, but on that occasion, she saw Kawasumi actually come quite narrow into midfield to make up that extra player and allowed the space for the fullback to kind of push on and make that run. But it seems to be something that the Japanese, their two wide midfielders, are quite comfortable to come in. We saw in the first half Nando quite often picking the ball up in the centre to kind of come in and get involved in the game to make that overload as well.
Head forward by Iwashimizu.
The difference in the style of England play, you often see Eni Aluko and Rachel Yankee as the wide forward players staying really wide to the touchline.
Well, it would have been an offside flag there, I think, had Farrah Williams been able to reach it. Another run down the flank, though, from Susie.
That's a good movement, a good idea, but again, that the timing of the run and certainly the weight of the pass and the accuracy of the pass need to be a lot better.
Miss Kamaki. And again.
Again, that's very much the style of their Japanese, is one of the centre midfielders will drop deep just to pick the ball up off the centre halves and then to link up and play the ball through the middle of the field.
Good cover there by Sophie Bradley, spotted the danger and cut it out. Mitsugi, I think she may have been told by a coach to get forward more in the second half, and there was a bit of holding there, I think, by Scott.
It's a couple of times, a couple of times that Jill Scott's just kind of lunged in and thought she can win the ball. But with the Japanese and their close control, they just often just dink back across the way the players come and just draw that foul. Saw one opportunity in the first half that they did the same. And on Anita Asante, another one that got a free kick.
So two over the ball. Kawasumi and Utsugi. Be Kawasumi, I'm sure, to deliver this for that cultured right foot of hers, and that's an excellent punch by Bardsley. And a couple of anxious moments in the first half, but that was really commanding from the England number one. Scott. England will want to try and get the likes of Asante, who just had possession, and Eni Aluko, Ellen White into the game as early as they can in the second half. You mentioned that England beat Japan in the group stage of the last World Cup. Japan went on to win the tournament the hard way. Beaten the USA, of course, famously on penalties in the final. Earlier, they'd beaten Germany in the quarterfinals, and they were on home soil, of course, in Sweden in the semis. So, I think anyone could turn around and say they didn't deserve to win the title. First Asian side to do so.
And again, I go back to the fact that they lost to England meant that they come runners-up and had to face Germany in the quarterfinals. So I really think that loss against England, that 2-0 defeat, you know, really was a bit of a checker for them and spurred them on. And they certainly went on and won the title the hard way against knocking out the hosts and the formidable Germans. Obviously Sweden, it would have been a very equal game, that one, and they come out on top. And I remember that final against America, they were absolutely all over in the first half, having shots off and missing the target, but got through them, but they stuck at it. And then in the second half, really come into the game and just fought hard against the power and the strength of America, but certainly deserved to win the title.
And they were behind twice, of course, in that game as well. Meanwhile, that's just got too much pace on it for Utsugi to be able to control. So Susie with the throw for England. 5 minutes gone in the second half, and still Hope Powell's girls lead by a goal to nil. Sakaguchi. Again, that looked like a handball, and this time England do get the decision. It's the substitute, Nakajima.
And the cross comes in. I think Laura Bassett just thinks she can nod that down to Anita Asante, but takes the deflection off of the hand quite clearly.
Just about got away with that clearance, Karen Barnsley. So easily a fall to a blue shirt rather than a white one. Oh no. Utsugi. Scott. Asante. This is White. Again, excellent control. That wasn't the easiest to take down, and she did it effortlessly. We'll have to go the long way round here, though. She's done a great job of holding it up. Susie tried to play her back in. In the end, Japan break it up.
Yeah, she does brilliant. Great control to keep the possession. And she didn't have much on, so she knew she just had to retain possession and maybe work it into the corner. But again, that's where you need Farrah Williams maybe to be getting a bit closer to her to support her when obviously we do have possession.
Picked up by Sakaguchi. Well, there's some space on this near side for Kawasumi. If that had been hit with a little less weight, she might have been in herself. As it is, she's kept it in play. Again, the cross was too deep. Asante has flicked out a foot at it.
Yeah, certainly right. That weight of pass from Ono needed to be a lot better, and she would have been in him.
Nothing else that Asante could do under pressure from Ajimi. Here's Kamaki.
Again, that's where you just need a little bit of communication on the pass to as it goes into Anita Sante's feet, to tell her to turn and just open up. She might not have been able to have that look herself, so that little bit of information for Farrah Williams as she passed the ball would have been key to allow us to keep possession.
Well, there's more danger here. Once again, it's overhit. I think Susie wanted to leave it, and in the end, it was Sophie Bradley who had to make the decision to get the ball clear. That's a quick throw, and it was a good spot. Bradley to the rescue, because Kawasumi there spotted an opportunity for Ono, and Japan might have been in. Just switched off a little bit from that quick throw, England. Now they have a corner to defend. Scott and Susie guarding both the posts. Kojima plays it in short.
Yeah, first time that Japan have looked for the short, but England unrailed to react very quickly.
So another corner for Japan. England deal with it well. There's a real up and under from Kawasumi. Touch was from Farrah Williams. And Bradley on the stretch. And he's knocks it up the pitch. Apart from being world champions, of course, Japan almost added Olympic gold to that. Beaten 2-1 by the USA in the final, so had to settle for silver. A bit overworked at the moment, Sophie Bradley.
Yeah, she's been in the right place at the right time, just shepherding in the run of Agimi. And again, that's she's good at reading the game. That's one strength of Sophie Bradley, and she's often there to make the tackle when needed.
Well, perfectly entitled to shoot on sight. Agimi there, it was almost an invitation. No one closed her down, and she got right underneath the shot.
Again, you could just see Agimi where she's actually dropped off of the back line and just come into that space between into the midfield and not quite been picked up. Not maybe the communication between the defence and the midfield to say who's actually having her to pick her up. But a shot way off of target.
Did think that Olympics, which I just mentioned, which was won by the USA beating Japan in the final, it was a real seminal moment for women's football in England, because that game when Great Britain beat Brazil just seemed to galvanise the whole nation. A lot of people who would maybe never watched a women's football match suddenly got right into it and realised, hang on, we've got some really good players here.
Yeah, and just to see a women's game on that kind of scale in that type of stadium, at Wembley Stadium, in that front of that many people. For years I've been involved in the game, and the argument that was always given out to you is, well, oh, your women's game would never fill Wembley or a stadium of that size. And obviously the Olympics is very special for all sports and galvanise the nations to come out and watch all sports, but women's football certainly showed its calibre, and it's been at that stand for a long time, but perhaps people in England just haven't seen it and have been aware of it. But I think from that Olympics there is a lot more following, and we saw it in the press and in the papers sometimes taking
There's no offside. Asante's in with a golden opportunity which he couldn't take to double the lead. We were waiting for a flag, it didn't come.
Yeah, it was good play by England, and Anita's just found a space between the defence and got forward. She's not often in those type of positions, and she's right to have that shot. She looks to try and drive it low with the laces, but you could see Rachel coming into the picture as well, saying, give me the ball, I could have scored as well. But I think she was right to shoot, but just didn't execute it.
Just one international goal for Anita Asante. So 63rd international this afternoon. As you said, she's not really used to being in those kind of one-on-one situations.
No, out of the midfielders in Jill Scott and Farrah Williams in that midfield, it's Anita that tends to be the more defensive-minded player. When I was in the squad, I used to play centre-half with her for a long period as well, so she has that ability to play in that position. But yeah, she's not known for getting into the final third, but when she does have the ability to finish. But you would expect a Farrah Williams or maybe Jill to be able to put that chance away a little bit better, just because they pop up in those positions a lot more.
Just wonder whether England will end up ruining that chance. We'll see in about half an hour's time.
Yeah, and I said it earlier, against these kind of teams and the Germanys, the Americans, they only get 2-3 chances in a game, and they inevitably score 90% of those chances. So you have to, you know, take those chances, and because we're good enough to make them, but it's just that last little bit of quality. And over the years, that was always what was lacking in our team as in England, but we've certainly improved at it.
A pretty quiet game, Lynn Anderson, which is what you want from a referee. I always say, if you don't notice her too much, she must be doing something right. Here's Aluko for England. Now Jill Scott. Into the feet of White. It's well kept in by Kawasumi. Oh, she's giving it straight to White now. That's really good play by Ellen White. Dangerous cross that's been hacked away for a corner in the end.
Yeah, I'd just like to see when Ellen White has been drawn out of the middle to come out wide to help, you know, keep possession and get the ball, that she needs a little bit more options. Like then I think that Rachel Yankee was getting into the box in that position, but the midfielder, certainly Farrah Williams in that 10 role, the top of the diamond in top of the triangle in midfield, that she needs to be that one really getting closer to Ellen and working with her. She needs to be doing it a lot more, I think.
Well, she's seen something she doesn't like. Ellen White being spoken to. Butter wouldn't melt, would it, Ellen White?
Yeah, she's been given the role of just trying to unsettle the keeper.
Corner deep to the far post. True by Enialuko. Williams, well there. Well, that's whipped in towards White. I think just momentarily she might have been a bit surprised it reached her. Some way off target with the effort, but England are looking threatening at the moment.
Yeah, again, Ennie's looked to kind of get the ball in. I thought at one point she was just going to drop it back to Sophie Bradley that was offering her support, but it eventually did come through to Ellen. She's taken it down well again, just here, it onside, but I think she would have preferred to be controlling that with her left and shooting with her right, but it just wasn't going to be on that occasion.
First touch, though, was excellent. We've seen three or four instant kills from her today. Balls are difficult to control, and she's done it superbly, giving herself the chance to shoot. Certainly England have had the better of the second half so far as Williams wins possession back. Now Scott. She was trying to find number 8 Asante, unable to do that.
Yeah, I think the start of this second half has been a bit scrappy by both teams. Not quite kept the tempo and precision in their passing that they did in the first half.
No way through that time for Kawasumi. Gone back though by Utsuki. And again. Not quite been the zip in the passing since we kicked off again from Japan that we saw for much of the first half. We know what they're capable of, I'm sure. Hope Power will hope we don't see too much more of it. Ariyoshi will just let this drift out and imagine. Ariyoshi wasn't involved in the London Olympics, named as just a reserve player. Here is a change though. Utsuki is coming off, and in her place, Kemiyonose. Midfielder to win her 20th cap. Kamiyanobe will slot probably into central midfield. England yet to make a change, but we understand changes are imminent. Watch that in a moment. Bradley back to Karen Bardsley. She's not had too much to do in the second half so far. I remember one good punch from a corner or a free kick and not much else. Well, that was well done by Laura Bassett. She could easily have been beaten by the bounce there. Is Kamagi. What's the substitute? Kaminobi. Now Kamagi again. excellent from Alex Scott. Realised that ball was going to bounce up. She had a chance to just nick possession. Well, at the moment, Faith, a distinctly limited threat coming from the world champions.
Yeah, I think I was just thinking that I think Hope will, considering she's had to, in this game, make three changes, in personnel, but in positional changes to what the back line would normally be. They've done a good job and they haven't been tested too much by the Japanese. But like I say, they're very good at just keeping to their game plan, and they often do play in front of you. It's not often they get in behind, but they will keep going to 90 minutes, and I'm sure they will carve out a couple of more opportunities. So they, you know, the back line need to keep focus. But I think Dunja Susi, she's obviously going off now. I think she's had a good game. I think she's done well. It's only a few times in the first half that Kawasumi got in behind her. But now we see Lucy Bronze come on for her debut.
Yeah, a big moment for Lucy Bronze. And the other player coming off here is Laura Bassett. And Jade Moore is going to come on for her.
Yeah, and I would imagine that Anita Sante would drop into the back line now, and Jade would take up a midfield position, and Lucy Bronze would probably just go right back for Dunja Susi, but we shall see.
Big moment for Lucy Bronze, her international debut. And it's only Jade Moore's fifth cap, the Birmingham midfielder.
But yeah, and that's the point where which Hope has to try things out in these friendlies because of the few injuries that she does have to, the Casey Stoney, Steph Horton as well in the back line.
As Lucy Bronze is teasing little ball, which might have caused Japan a problem.
This will be a huge moment for Lucy, and it's brilliant to see because she's been out of the game for a long time with injuries. I think she said it's 3 years in all with various different injuries, but the last one being quite a long injury to her cartilage, I think it was, and it's kept her out for Everton. But then she's since come back, played for Liverpool, and has been doing well, and that's warranted her selection.
Well, this looks like it's going to be a yellow card for Jill Scott. I think it was Sakaguchi, was it?
It's actually for Jade Moore, Jade I Moore. Believe. It's just come on. Yeah, she just, well, in that occasion, just I think it's a trip. It's a bit innocuous, really. The first one, I would say, she's coming in from behind, but she doesn't really take her down. But it's there, it's just a trip. It's a bit harsh, I think, for a booking.
I'm not sure she meant it. It's been a tangle of legs. Was a free kick, that's for sure. Sakaguchi was goal side of her. So confirmation of the caution to Jade Moore, and Japan midway through the second half with a free kick in a dangerous position. Saw one in the first half which didn't really connect. I think it was Ono, was it, who hit that one? Or a Jimi. Might have been a Jimi, but yeah, there's no problem for Bardsley. Let's see if she can keep this one out. Deflection. Don't think it would have troubled Karen Bardsley anyway. It was Kami Inoue who had the effort.
I think it's Ellen White in the wall. Second player in the wall just gets ahead to it.
Kami Inoue will take this Japan corner. Six waiting in the penalty area. It was a poor corner, but it was a very decent flick, and Bardsley had to be really alert to make the save.
Well, with Japan, you never know whether this is actually work, because you see Agumi making that run, and they do look to pay to feet rather than in aerially around corners. But I thought the same, that it was
looked
a
like a miss-hit corner, didn't it?
Yeah, definitely. But you kind of wonder with them, is it something off the training ground? But as she made such a definite run into that position.
I think maybe it was a training ground routine, but I'm sure she didn't strike the corner the way she wanted to strike it. But it nearly paid off for them. Good save by Bardsley. Well, England absolutely convinced that was a corner, and they're correct. So a second goal would be a massive bonus here. Scott is there, White is there. Aluko to deliver the in-swinger here. This time England goes short, now they wish they had. You think with the height advantage they have, that it might be better just playing a more orthodox corner.
Yeah, I've seen Jill Scott, you've got someone who's able to, taller than most and able to get ahead on the things, head on corners, I mean, but and without Steph Horton, she's another one. Ellen White in the team, she's quite deadly at set pieces.
It's Jill Scott's cross, and it was Rachel Yankee's shot. And in the end, Kyori relatively comfortably made the save. Just that horrible moment for the goalkeeper. She thought it might loop over her, but saved it safely enough.
Yeah, good spot by Jill Scott to pick out Rachel Yankee. She takes it down well, and it's on her left foot, and she's absolutely right to have a crack at that, and certainly on this occasion would have been great for her to mark this game with a goal.
In by Lucy Bronze, and as far as Yankee, and some way wide goal kick from Jade Moore.
Looks like they're preparing to make another substitution.
Well, while Hope ponders that possible change, England are driving forward again. Aluko, nice little burst of acceleration, but the pass inside to White, not accurate. By Sakaguchi. Telegraph the pass, that was never going to reach Nakajima. Now Scott.
Again, in this kind of situation, I think it's important that England just look to keep the ball. But to break a team down like Japan, they're going to have to keep moving and not let the tempo drop too much. But it's good to see spells of the game where the control in the possession. But if you slow it down too much, you'll see that Japan will just crowd you out. As they, you know, they work hard when they're not in possession and to close the ball and often get two players round, you know, to close it down. But so they just you sometimes passing if you're not penetrating them is dangerous and you can, you know, be a little bit sloppy or just they nick it and then they're away.
Just coming into this game a little bit more in the last 5 or 10 minutes. Knocked away calmly enough by Lucy Bronze. And it was more up than out by Kumagi, but it's worked out well for Japan. They've got the ball back. By Ono.
You often find when a few substitutions have been made that the team just, you know, need to keep possession just to allow those players to settle in, but also just to get your team shape. And certainly when your midfielders move back into the back line for those, you know, those the communication just to be crisp between the players and not, you know, allow the, like I said earlier, the tempo to drop or for sloppy passes to creep in.
Now it was by White, but she's given it away. This is danger here for England with Kawasumi on the charge. And the follow-up deflected shot from Kumagi. Deflection took all the sting out of it. don't often say this about the world champions, I don't want to tempt fate, but to me they just look like they're running a little bit short of ideas here. Saw so much pass and move football form in the first half. Just as I say that, they threaten, but Asante stepped in there at centre-half as though she'd been playing there her whole career.
Yeah, well, like I said, she's had periods within her career where she has played there. Actually, during the last European Championship, she was at centre-half, like I said, with myself, for long periods. So that she won't feel uncomfortable in that position.
Lucy Bronze has made a very confident start since she's come on her debut.
And like I said, I think for most, she might have been a bit of a surprise. Oh, Farrah Williams just given again, a bit sloppy.
Yeah, giving it to
Ono. Conceded possession.
And Ono still has it. And Ono might go on her own. And she's fed it into her teammate. And that's 1-1. Kawasumi gets the equaliser, but in truth, it came gift-wrapped.
Yeah, and that's really disappointing. We were kind of mentioning earlier that just a few minutes ago, actually, that you can't allow it to become sloppy or take your focus off the ball. And I will say that Farrah Williams, in that sense, has done it. And under no pressure, really, doesn't get control of the ball there. And she'll be the first to put her hand up there. But then really makes no attempt to try and win the ball back either. And that's disappointing to see for someone that's so experienced. And the team's worked hard and had chances to go 2-0 up. And to allow a team like Japan back into it when they don't maybe deserve it as much just through an error is really disappointing.
Kawasumi's 11th international goal, 44th cap today. Absolutely nothing that Karen Bardsley could do about that.
No, and that's, again, it's sloppy play that's allowed Japan back into it, and certainly it's disappointing to see.
So out of nothing, really, Japan on terms with, 13 and a half minutes remaining in Burton. This is Ellen White. Scott. She was trying to find Lucy Bronze. Didn't manage to do that. And now Kawasumi has ridden the challenge. Japan are on the march again, but Bradley able to get it clear.
Yeah, again, England now just need to get their shape, need to be a lot more composed on the ball. And I'm sure Japan, having just taken advantage of scoring, will look to apply more pressure. So they need to really keep their concentration now, England.
Clearly given Japan a bit of confidence scoring the goal. Asante's header went down into a very dangerous area. A little fortunate, ball didn't break to either Ono or Ajimi, but it didn't. Just get the feeling England might have to weather this storm now. Safely through to Bardsley, though.
I was saying earlier, Lucy Bronze, that's just on the ball now. I think she was even surprised to be included, having only been brought into the squad once before. But for me, I'm surprised we don't have a lot of cover on the left side, and Steph Holton was slightly injured at the end of the WSL. I think she, by all the reports, will be fine, but I think just to have a bit more cover. I know Casey Stoney can play there too. And obviously trying Alex Scott out there today, but not to have any other left-footed player in the squad apart from Rachel, naturally left-footed, or someone that plays in that position week in, week out for their club, is a bit of a surprise for me. But I know it's not just Hope, it's Brent Hills who sees these young girls at under 23 level as well that would have been helping Hope make her decision, although I'm sure it's her final decision at the end of to pick that 23 players that she has.
Forward by Bradley to the ball. Scott did well there. Williams. It's a nice ball too. In the end though, no way through for Alex Scott. Worked by Ariyoshi, right back. were trying to give them a problem again. This time the clearance was by Nusafune.
I think Alex Scott can be pleased with her performance today. Having played on the right for so long, to change onto the left is sometimes hard. Steph Holton has had to do it. She's often played in midfield as well. But she's not looked to just do the safe things and stay back. She's looked to get forward as well. And you can't say that the Japanese winger has got in behind her too often either. It's just disappointing that it's a sloppy error and mistake of lack of concentration that has allowed Japan to equalise this game.
Well, that's a really intelligent ball from Hajime. And that crashes back off the outside of the post. Not sure if it was a shot. Given the benefit of the doubt, it was a very tight angle. But certainly Nakajima got really good contact. Barnsley was grateful to see it come back off the frame of the goal. Japan may not be finished here, but they will be for now because of an offside flag. Near thing that for England.
Yeah, they actually have got down that right side there. I was just saying they haven't had too much opportunities in the game, but here she does. And I'm actually think she's looking to just drive that across the penalty box, looking to just drive it across to see if her forwards can get on it. But she's cracked the post and bit fortunate if that would have gone in for her.
Yeah, you can see from the angle of her body it was intended for a teammate in the middle, but it nearly worked for her. Here's Ellen White. 10 minutes to go here. And more changes. Jordan Nobbs is going to come on in place of Jill Scott.
Yeah, Jordan will just replace a straight swap for Jill Scott in midfield. And the fourth official's got her work cut out now, doing so many substitutions close together, can't quite get the numbers in quick enough. And it looks like an Enia Luko is coming off for Jess Clark, which is again a straight swap on the right.
Jess Clark is on, place of Enia Luko. Another look at the goal. I mean, they took it really well between them, but England will look back and think that was a bit of a gift.
Yeah, but again, the defence was on the black foot after Farrah Williams has given away the possession, and then Sophie Bradley's done her most to try and hold her to up. And Tony Duggan's just taken up the centre forward position for a straight swap for Ellen White. But again, it's good to see Hope make so many changes to allow these girls to get the experience of a bit of game time leading into the tournament, and the experience against playing, you know, a team like Japan. Jess Clark has a number of caps under her belt now and is used to this, but certainly Jordan Nobbs, Tony Duggan have four or five caps each. And Jordan Nobbs done brilliantly to score in her debut in the Cyprus Cup against Italy, scoring a cracking 25-yard goal.
Lovely piece of skill that from Farrah Williams, wasn't it? Most South American. Well, they want to flag Japan, they're not going to get one. That was a decent effort. Really good game, she said, Alex Scott. You mentioned it a moment ago, and that one has just crowned it.
Yeah, I think it's a great little reverse pass by Rachel Yankee to find Alex Scott, because she's made that run, and the Japanese defence, two centre halves, were quite deep on their six-yard line that kept her onside. But to be in that position, that's the positive of being left back, is when she does cut in, she can come in and use her right foot for shots or even for crossing that ball into the box.
Well, more changes. It's that time of the game, isn't it? Ono's going off. Iwabuchi is on. And also about to come is Maruyama. So Karina Maruyama. And she is on in place of Kawasumi. So just 6 minutes remaining here in Burton. Both teams now much changed from the starting 11s, and nothing to separate them. That was Alex Scott again. The attendance, by the way, the capacity here at Burton's just shy of 7,000. The reports I heard yesterday were that we're hoping it would be around the 4,000 mark, and look at that, nearly 5,500. Terrific crowd, bearing in mind kickoff here was 1:45 on a work day.
Yeah, definitely. I know you can see in the stands a lot of young school children in their uniforms. So a lot of work's been done with the local schools to give them the opportunity to come and see the world champions and England, the team that they can get behind in the European Championship. So for that to happen at, like you say, this time in the afternoon is brilliant. And it's important for the girls to have their last home game before they go off to Sweden. There is a full stadium, because they'll be having bigger crowds. They're very much used to it now, playing in front of big crowds, but it's just good to have that support behind you, and also important for the young boys and girls in the crowd to see, you know, these role models on the field doing their England and country proud.
Well, it's got to be better having a day out at the football than being behind a desk at school, that's for sure. Asafune is the one who's come off worse. Farrah Williams is okay. Asafune still down. Last thing that Hope Powell needs, any new injury problems, but I think they're both okay. Just got a problem with her elbow or a shoulder, I think, Asafune. But it's an England free kick. Williams. Just a bit undecided for a moment there. Coming in OB. In the end, put it out. Confirmation of that other change that Japan have made. Nicely done by Duggan. Clark. Always difficult when you come on as a substitute so late in the game, kind of pick up the pace of the match and make any kind of contribution in the few remaining minutes.
Yeah, like I said, there's been a lot of substitutions, so it kind of does disrupt the flow of the team. But it is hard for those players too to get, like say, get up into the pace, and certainly, you know, you want to make use of every minute you have, and sometimes you would like maybe a bit longer to be able to impress, certainly for those young players that have just come on towards the end. But it's important for the players on the field that have played the whole game and the more experienced ones, just to get them into position quickly, keep talking to them, and you know, ensure it doesn't have too much of an impact.
Asafune is the latest to be withdrawn, and Asuna Tanaka, Kobe defender, is on in her place. With all the substitutions that we've had, a couple of injuries as well, it's anyone's guess how much stoppage time might be added on. Just got fractionally over a minute of normal time to play, and at this stage you would imagine if there is another goal, whoever scores it will win the game. Free kick to England again. All the way in, and they've scored in the final minute. It's not going to win goal of the season. Is it Bradley who got the last touch, or has it been allowed? No, it won't be. The stadium almost erupted there, but Lynn Anderson has seen something which the replay may be able to tell us, but it's not going to count.
It was actually Lucy Bronze that puts it in the back of the net. It's a little flick on by Tony Duggan at the front post. And maybe even Jess. I can't see why that's not been allowed from first glances at that. I think it's an offside.
I'd like to see that just a couple of times more to make a decision. England trying to go forward again. We're inside time added on.
That's a real shame though for Lucy Bronze, obviously, to come on in such a poor game, to have been up there in on that set piece and to have maybe have just done enough to tap it in, but it's been ruled out.
Three minutes of added time. So close to stealing this right at the death. Meanwhile, there may still be a chance. I don't think Jess Clark's going to reach that.
Yeah, Lucy Bros, the great run, just driving out of the back line, bringing the ball forward. Opted to play the ball into Tony, but she's not, you know, not got the right weight of pass on that pass to Jessica. Lucy could have even played it out to her first time as well.
That'd be a free kick to Japan this time. Iwabuchi, the player who was fouled by Asante. It would be really cruel on England if this free kick came to anything. They have to keep their concentration for the minute and a bit that remains here. Inoue with the free kick for Japan, and I think that came off an England head last. It did, it's a corner.
Yeah, come off Jade Moore's just risen to nudge it on. Does well just to get up and make sure it clears the danger. But it just gives Japan a corner, so they need to get in position quickly and set up, be concentrating for this ball coming in so late on in the game.
Kami Inoue's taken just about every set play since she came on as a substitute. This would surely be a winner now if they score here. Barnsley with the double-fisted punch, and it's exactly what Mariyama was trying to do, just the side foot lob, but fortunately for Barnsley it was straight at her.
Yeah, she didn't get enough weight behind it, because it was the right idea, because Barnsley was out of a 6-yard area, but again it's got to be a pretty good lob to get over the height that Karen can with her outstretched arms. But she does well in the first instance to come out and punch the cross.
But this might be last chance territory for England to get a winner. It's Jess Clark. We've played the 3 minutes. Can she find a cross? Still going. I think she's run that out herself. She has. Well, final whistle here at the Pirelli Stadium, and honours even between England and the world champions Japan. England in front through Eni Aluko just before half-time. Wonderful pass from Rachel Yankee. But then the equaliser arriving 75 minutes in. Kawasumi the scorer, and it means the final score here in Bern is England 1, Japan 1. We can have a look at some of the highlights, Faye. England, I think, will look back at the 90 minutes as a whole. I think they had more chances. This was a really big opportunity for Asante only in the second half.
Yeah, it was, and she had time to think about it. Great run and great ball through. Big gap there in the Japanese defence, but she's just not quite. She's gone for the power rather than maybe the accuracy. And the keeper's done well, doesn't allow her that much, but she's gone for that far corner, but she's not quite accurate enough.
This was the corner that they had that was flicked on by Ajimi. There was a slight miss hit, but it's a good save, sharp save from Barnsley.
Yeah, and again, I pointed out in the previous few corners that Ajimi just looked to be unmarked in set pieces, and again, there she was, and she's driven across, and she can't be allowed to do that.
This was Rachel Yankee's effort, which nearly sneaked under the bar and over Kaori.
Yeah, didn't quite. She does well to take it down and get make room for it for a left foot shot, but doesn't quite get the power, and it's an easy take for the keeper in the end, but you could see what she was trying to do.
And then, just when it looked as though England had taken the sting out of Japan, they rather gifted them an equaliser.
Yeah, and like I say, I think Farah, she'll hold her hands like she has to, because watching this replay, she'll see that she gives possession and makes no attempt to win the ball back hard enough. She should be biting at the feet of Ono to get that ball back. Bradley's trying to hold her up. But here, as soon as she realises, you've got to react. She's got to work hard to get back. And there, make the tackle, put pressure on her, stop her from being able to pick up a Sophie Bradley. She just drops in, and I don't know why she's doing that. And it may sound like I'm being a bit harsh on Farah, but I know I'm not, because she's a better player than that. And it's disappointing for them, Japan, to, you know, because they'll get a chance like that and they will put it away and score. But here, someone needs to put the pressure on her, needs to make her make a mistake, and certainly Farah needs to be that player as the midfielder. And Lucy Bronze desperately trying to get back there, but Karen Barsi can't do anything really, because she's taken that chance well.
Yeah, it's a really cool finish. And international goal number 11 for Kawasumi. Ball coming 75 minutes in. And this was the other scare England had late on. Was supposed to be a cross, but so nearly put Japan ahead.
Yeah, it's one of the few times that they kind of got in behind, down the wings, behind the England defence, and it looked like Karen Barsley was quick to react and kind of scrambling to cover, because she is expecting the cross, but fortunate that it's hit the post, but certainly that was looking to be a cross. And here's good, great little play by England down that left side, which had been the case all day. Alex Scott doing brilliantly to support Rachel Yankee throughout the match, and like I say, not a natural position to be on the left side, but here comes in and looks to get a shot away. Really positive and really impressed with her game today. Really attacked it well.
Let's have a look at this again. See if we can see why it was disallowed.
I think it's Jess Clark there. Yeah. As the ball's flicked on by Tony Duggan, Jess Clark is in on offside position, and Lucy Bronze, and you would see that she's interfering with play because she's almost headed it into the net herself. But it's really disappointing. So it would have been great for Lucy Bronze to have marked it with her debut with a winner. And
just a brief final word from you, Faye, in terms of how you think Hope Howe will assess that performance so close to the European Championships.
I think she'll be really positive. I think she's made a lot of changes, and maybe not the strongest team that she would normally have put out, but a very solid performance. And like I say, Japan didn't have too many chances, and for parts of the game we controlled the game well, and we made some good chances ourselves, probably the better of chances of the game. So, and to add so many players in, you can see it become scrappy, but it's good for those players to get the experience, and this is what those games are for. So, but generally she'll be positive, and she'll just be disappointed with how they've scored.
Well, never a bad thing when you hold the world champions, and that's what Hope Powell's side have done. 1-1 the final score here from Burton. From me, Trevor Harris, and for Faye White, I hope you've enjoyed our coverage. And remember to follow all the latest breaking news on the England women's team on FA TV. From all of us here, a very good afternoon.